Assalamualaikum. Yeah. Room group at A, we're presenting a case on surgery and infectious disease. Patient data, male, 45 years old. He was admitted to ED after an accident with massive abdominal injury. He was unconscious and hypertension. He has hypertension and he smoked 5 stick cigarettes per day. On day 1, he was admitted to ED with massive abdominal injury, unconscious and hypertension. CT scan show he was bleeding in peritoneum and was immediately sent for surgery. And during surgery, 4 liter ringulated and also 6 units of whole blood was infused to the patient. But patient remained hypertension during the surgery despite resuscitation. And on day 3 post-surgery, his level of consciousness began to deteriorate. And IV amikacin was initiated to this patient. And on day 5 post-surgery, patient condition continued to deteriorate and he was re-intubated and connected to the ventilator.
Continuing with current diagnosis or clinical condition, on day 3 post-surgery, the patient is suspected to have sepsis with SIRS. Sepsis 3 defines sepsis as life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by dysregulated host response leading to physiological and biochemical abnormalities, often with signs of acute organ dysfunction. Organ dysfunction is defined by acute changes in total SOFA score at least 2 consequent to the infection. Evidences of SIRS is from the patient's temperature of 39, heart rate of 118 beats per minute, respiratory rate of 28 breaths per minute, and WBC count of 25,000. When assessed at the SOFA score, the patient's P to F ratio of 200%, platelet level of 168,000 per microliter, MAP of 85 mmHg, and urine output of 10 ml per hour for 3 hours give a total as SOFA score of 6. Therefore, this patient has met sepsis definition criteria of suspected infection and total SOFA score at least 2. For appropriate management of the disease, priorities in treating sepsis. First, culture and sensitivity testing is important to clearly identify type of organisms and for the escalation therapy after CNS results are obtained. Second, to treat underlying infection with IV antibiotic, broad spectrum antibiotics should be given within 1 hour of sepsis. According to NAG 2019, first line therapy for severe sepsis is IV piperacillin tazobactam plus minus amikacin. Source control is also important to remove any potential infected line or drain access. Third is to restore hemodynamics by giving IV fluid bolus, such as crystalloid solution, to maintain hemodynamic.
Right, moving on, we should always continuously assess our patient condition by measuring the lactate concentration and also constant monitoring of the vital signs to quickly rule out septic shock. Vasopressors should also be initiated with patients with septic shock criteria, which includes the mean arterial pressure lesser than 65 and also serum lactate more than 2. So post-surgery day 5, we can see that patient has a mean arterial pressure of 62 and also failed to respond despite aggressive fluid resuscitation, and hence we recommend no epinephrine as a first choice vasopressor with a dose of 0.01 to 3 mcg per kg per minute. Next, possible drug-related problems, where the empiric broad-spectrum therapy is known to have one or more antimicrobials to cover all likely pathogens. However, post-surgery day 3, we can see that only amikacin was given to this patient for a broader gram-negative coverage. We know that aminoglycoside alone is difficult to achieve on an individual level without a broader range of rapid therapeutic drug monitoring option. And hence, often, combination therapy with 2 different classes of antibiotics, usually a beta-lactam with a fluoroquinolone aminoglycoside or macrolide, is given. So, patient condition worsened on day 5, you can see, suggesting that amikacin alone was insufficient to control the infection, and also the coverage of empiric broad spectrum therapy is insufficient.
For pharmacist intervention, firstly, de-escalation therapy is needed. After obtaining the CNS results, the administered antibiotic with broad spectrum should be switched to the antibiotics with narrower spectrums. Secondly, appropriate prophylactic antibiotics should be given to prevent the surgical site infections. If it was orthopedic surgery, cetriazole should be the prophylactic antibiotic. If it was abdominal surgery, then the prophylactic antibiotic could be given according to the one that's stated in the diagram. Moving on, if the vessel pressure and the fluid resuscitation are not sufficient to restore the hemodynamic stability in patients with septic shock, corticosteroid could be given as adjunctive therapy. Besides, as patient has hypertension, he will have 2-fold increase in likelihood of developing DVT. Pharmacological prophylaxis like low molecular weight heparin and low dose of unfractionated heparin could be given. For the mechanical prophylaxis, patient could wear the DVT compression stockings.
Okay, next, prophylaxis of ventilator-associated pneumonia, VAP, should be given. VAP is the common nosocomial infection which commonly infected critically ill patients that is associated with poor clinical outcome, including increased hospital and ICU stay. The IHR ventilator bundles will help in significant reduction in VAP rates. Next, pharmacists can give patient education on smoking cessation. Smoking is a major risk factor for respiratory and other systematic infection and cardiovascular disease. Moving on the monitoring planning, we need to assess the effectiveness and safety of the treatment. First, monitor the site of infection, monitor the vital signs such as temperature, blood pressure, monitor the white blood cell count. The reduction in white blood cell count may indicate the patient infection is improving. Monitor the procalcitonin level, which responds to the bacterial infection. Monitor the lactate level. The lactate level is patient having sepsis, thus a decline in the lactate level near to the normal range around 0.5 to 1 millimol per liter. Monitor the C-reactive protein once within 4 to 5 days to determine any improvement of systemic inflammation after started the antibiotics and carry out the calcium and sensitivity test. The CNS test need to be done to determine the appropriate use of antibiotics and need to be carried out 72 hours after starting the antibiotics. For the safety, we need to monitor signs of neurotoxicity, nephrotoxicity, vestibular toxicity, as patients started on amikacin. Also need to assess the hearing parameters using audiogram to monitor the renal profile of the patient, monitor for sign of hypersensitivity reaction. And this is the list of our references, and that's all from us. Thank you.
Thank you.